few are presented with an opportunity to seize greatness. In beautiful Southern California, the PGF Championships introduce that opportunity of a lifetime. It's North America's best of the best. It's a celebration of the sport, and a champion is crowned now.
That's a title! And it heads back to the Deep South in Birmingham, Alabama, where the Thunderbolts win it all. They are victorious in this, the 18U Premier Division National Championship. They won it all at PGF.
Picturesque Southern California and an event with so much history on the banks of the Pacific. From Newport Beach to Irvine, California, it's not too far of a trip, this historic venue. Bill Barber Park, this is Deanna Manning Stadium in the heart of a bedroom community of Irvine, California. The Beverly Bandits, they come from home, which is in the Midwest, the south side of Chicago, from Fort Myers, Florida. They avoid storms at every cause, and then they turn the heads of those that are watching, causing a storm on the diamond. This is a beautiful look at what is an amazing stop along this softball two weekends here at the Premier Girls Fast Pitch 18U National Champion Premier Division. Hi there, folks. She won a lot when she played. This is a national champion, an Olympic gold medalist, introducing Amanda Freed. My name is Darren Sutton, and what makes this fun, and by the way, it's all competition. It's not an exhibition game. Is this the final chance for these athletes before they go to college, and there are 30 commits combined in this game today before they go to college to play one last time with their travel team.
And if you're a high school athlete, softball player, this is ultimately where you want to finish off your career. On this stage, PGF Nationals, both of these teams have been here before. A lot of these athletes have, and they want to finish off their career strong and take the title today.
And again, these teams have been playing out here. It started with their opening ceremonies, a wonderful celebration. And then the college coaches that have seen them play, all these athletes are committed, certainly. An opportunity to meet them all one by one. Let's turn it over to the in-house great voice of Premier Girls Fast Pitch. Let's ask Fred Salas to take it away. Fred?
Deanna Manning Stadium in beautiful Irvine, California for the 2023 Premier Girls Fast Pitch National Championship. This afternoon, the 18U Premier National Championship title game between the visiting Beverly Bandits and Rock Hill. Introducing first the Beverly Bandits down the right field line. Number 27, Wrigley Fenter. Number 42, Madison Patrick. Number 7, Jalen Salas. Number 28, Lindsay Mullen. Number 13, Emily York. Number 22, Sophia Freeland. Number 24, Michaela Barney. It's starting lineup. At center field, number 21, Ryan Blackwell. In left field, number 15, Callie Meredith. At shortstop, number 10, Gabby Comilla. First base, number 19, Eileen Donahue. Designated player, number 4, Andy Adams. At catcher, number 44, Lynn Christopher. in right field, number 11, Emma Lovis. At third base, number 30, Julia Larson. At second base, number 2, Karen Bailey. Number 16, Sage Majeka. Number 15, Kay Rivers. Gabby Rubles. Kay Rubles. Number 14, Madison Molina. Number 6, Lexi Fitzgerald. Number 2, Reese Wells. Number 3, Haley Bradley. Number 9, Faith Horton. And now the Rock Bulls starting lineup. At center field, number 17, Kylie Shaw. At third base, number 21, Julia Nowler. At first base, number 11, Cassidy Bryant. At catcher, number 8, Katie Campbell. In right field, number 33, Megan Rasmussen. Designated player, number 24, Sophia Kardaski. At second base, number 42, Kirsten Stevens. At shortstop, number 4, Jazz Jones. In left field, 00, Lexi DeFato. And the flex pitcher, number 82, Skylar Wagner. Assistant coach Joe Sassone.
Let's go!
And head coach
go!
The Rock Bowl, Johnny
Irvine, California, Deanna Manning Stadium. I hope you had fun getting to know these athletes. So many of them heading off to college. Lila Blackwell is a name that we're excited to talk about at the very top of things for the Beverly Band, and she is headed to Virginia Tech. Callie Meredith right behind her. Gabby Comey is an All-American. She is one of the more talented middle infielders. She's headed to Florida. You will see in the nation Eileen Donahue, Annalie Adams, Olivia Christopher, Emma Lotus, Julia Larson, Kernan Bailey. Again, this historic Beverly Bandits team and their coach Bill Conroy. When you think about the 18U age group, the Beverly Bandits, 18U premier champs back in 2017, they also won it that same year in 2017 into 16U age group. But that 16 and 17 team combined, when you put them together, they were great. They won it all at the 16U, then the next year the 18U, which is a unique story, but maybe not as unique as what's going on in that third base dugout when you look at Rock Moneta. This is a team that played in the Platinum Division, and to simplify it for you, Skylar Wagner anchors their team in the circle, Jacksonville University commit. The Platinum Division is the lower division, if you will, but it's still really competitive. If you win at the Platinum Division, as we take a look at Rock Gold defensively as they work behind Skyler, Defato, Shaw, Rasmussen, Noller, Jones, Stevens, Punt, Bryant, and Campbell doing the catching. They did win it. They won the whole thing last year, so they earned the right to play in the premier. In other words, you're bounced up. But they're in the finals again, a lot of these same players.
Well, I mean, you wonder a little bit if they had been in the premier division last year and not done as well, would they still have that same fire to rebuild to get back to this point? I love that they were able to accomplish that this year.
Blackwell from Roncalli High School from Indiana played 99 career games in her high school career, and boy, what a career it's been. A 5-15 career hitter, and it was on the 21st day of October in 2021 that she committed to play at Virginia Tech. Skyler, pretty good curveball called just off the plate outside, 1-1 the count.
Skyler's got some great command and movement on her pitches. Coming from that left side, she'll work both sides of the plate. We've already seen both sides in her first two pitches.
Scott is from Melbourne, Florida. Goes right over that outside corner. Same pitch, got a little bit more of the plate. Went to Vieira High School, graduated this year, and did some great things in the classroom. She's a Jacksonville commit, fell in love with the school, really connected with who she is as a human with the coaching staff. The daughter of Laurel and Christopher Wagner. And you want to talk about being inspired. Now, I'm sure her older sister, Morgan, is watching proud of her younger sister pitching in the title game. That being said, Morgan, who is 23 years old, is in the Air Force, serving in Okinawa currently, calling both sisters, call one another best friends. And we thank her older sister for her service. Staying stubborn, everything spinning, everything away so far.
Yeah, just trying to get Blackwell to chase something away.
Bandits love being and playing as the away team, the visitors, if you will. Early pressure. That's always been a style. Ouch. Blackwell is on. The future Hokie here, right around the corner, as a matter of fact. We'll head to first, and here comes some of that Bill Conroy-led pressure.
You're just covering that whole play. Look at that front foot, white, right on the chalk line. That pitch a little inside after going away a couple of pitches. Wagner tries to come back to the inside part. It's a great at back by Blackwell.
Back in your home in Wisconsin, but still joining this squad is Callie Meredith. She's a 2023. She's headed down south to Miami to play at Florida International University. She said, as a Midwestern athlete, I wanted to go somewhere where it was warm, as she's in the hole 0-1. So FIU is the perfect location. Loves the coaching staff. After one visit, she knew it was the place for her. Daughter of Deb and Steve. And there are four Meredith sisters at home. Takes that one with her up the first baseline, and it's foul.
It's a really great idea, and we saw how effective that bunt up the first baseline is. We saw it a couple of times in our last game. You catch that first baseman off guard, second base pulled a little up the middle. But the Bandits are really good with their run game, their short game. They've got a lot of power.
In on the hands, the Kekana, Wisconsin native has it. Got it up and turned into a double play. Punt Bryant turned around, and right there waiting on the flip was Stevens. Great job working together, an effective pitch to tie up Meredith.
Blackwell was off on the pitch. You can see she's got so much speed, just picks her head up a little too late. That catch nicely made, a good reach, and then takes her time to make sure her teammate gets over to receive that throw for the double out, for the double play.
Here is a high school All-American. She'll get a chance to play on this same network later on tonight. We'll have it for you. This is an incredible player as we meet Gabby Comia, who is committed to go play at the University of Florida in the powerhouse of the SEC from St. John, Indiana. Playing the Futures game tonight. and in all likelihood have a chance to be an All-American next year. A 2024, essentially playing up to be on this deep roster. That speaks to her talent. Wicked curveball, and it's rare that you see Gabby miss that badly, but she did. The daughter of Dennis and Stacy Comia. I played baseball, football, and college football as well. Mom, volleyball, played college basketball, so an athletic family. Two and two the count.
I think Wagner is a great matchup for the Bandits so far. We've seen three straight left-handed hitters that can use the short game and swing away. And Wagner's got some nice break to both sides of the plate, but that outside curveball can be really deadly to lefties.
Out of the box quickly, fouling it off. Gabby will get another chance. Still plays high school basketball. Finds that it adds depth at Hanover Central High School and makes her a better softball player. Was a gymnast for a long time when she was younger as well. Said it, gymnastics gave her a ton of her athletic ability. Easy chance right into the glove. Pomp Bryant with a couple of nice plays this inning. Those are some tough hitters right there. The Wagner just worked through. Just underway, 18U premiere. That isn't the future of the sport. I'm not quite sure what is. Come on, Mom. I need to go play. Hold my Gatorade for a minute. I'm out. Speaking of out, Sage Marjetko had a ton of them yesterday for this Conroy team. She's going to be a handful for Rock Gold, Shaw, Noller, Punt Bryant are the first three. Campbell Rasmussen, Gardetsky, Stevens, Jones, DeFato all the way down. And Kylie Shaw to lead things off. Sage threw a no-hitter yesterday. Winner's bracket play as she fires a strike. A 1-0 masterpiece against the Mojo team, Daniel Fisher team. In the 18U bracket, she struck out 15 in that game. And had enough support. Only run she needed, Analia Adams, who's going to Auburn, homered. That was, by the way, Audrey Lowry, an Oklahoma commit against Sage Marjetko in that game. PGF, you can find, even on a backfield, not the stadium, you're finding that game.
Well, it was exciting the last couple of days leading up to today's games, just the matchups. I couldn't stop watching Game Changer and the different, you know, brackets being played out. And there were some teams that lost early in the tournament and made some deep runs into yesterday. I mean, playing four and five games in a day, got really exciting.
Sage, a South Carolina commit. That's the outside corner, two and two to count. What do we know about her stuff? Who is she as a pitcher?
Well, she's a power pitcher. She stays down in the zone really well, but can also go up. So she just mixes really well, and you can see the leverage and command, her poise in the circle. And that's why she's going to South Carolina. She's been really consistent for this team.
Battery made Liv Christopher holds on to that one. Number 44, Christopher, her best friend, at least this day today.
Look at the spin on that drop in the late break. Christopher now, hanging on.
Third baseman, number 21, Julia Noller.
Another left-handed bat, Julia Noller, the third baseman in the two spot. Sage Marjetko. A fierce spin on that screwball as it runs away. Sage is the daughter of Joe and Kim as she works against Julia. Clemson commit. Leaking out front, but it's pretty well struck. Back just shy of the wall, making the play is Emma Lotus. Pulled the string on her, had her out front.
Yeah, an early look at that off-speed pitch. That'll be a factor in today's game. And you've got a hard-throwing pitcher who throws down. That changeup looks just like the drop ball, so it has the ability to cause a lot of mishits.
Pomp Bryant with her chance now. Nice play by Lotus. First step, turn, got to the spot, then made the play. It's a strong defense, and again, they're ready for a strike thrower. Let's introduce that defense quickly. Meredith Blackwell, Lotus in the outfield. Gabby Ankerstinks at shortstop, Bailey right next to her. It's Larson and Donahue. Liv Christopher held on to strike three to start this inning, working behind the plate. Sticks. Who doesn't like to be a hitter known as Sticks? Obviously, that doesn't always tie to the bat. That ties to the number. Anyone that wears that number 11 can wear the nickname of Sticks as well. Cassidy Pontbriant makes a screwball to misses outside from Sage. Sage has a big fan club, by the way. It's just not her and mom and dad at home. It's Jade, it's Nina, it's Callie, Michael, Rhea, and Mila. A large family, the Marchette goes. A lot of love. Well, that's firm, isn't it? One and two, the count.
And she throws it all through the zone, so that's got that up spin on it. But look, that's not a rise ball at the eyes. That's a rise ball right at the belt.
Cassidy, a Jacksonville commit as well. Blew her away. Electric screwball there with some teeth. She spun a no-no in the winner's bracket on her way here. Does she want to do it in the title game? That stuff's electric. First inning in the book, scoreless. Excited to see these athletes play, and we will have that one for you streaming on ESPN3. The Watch ESPN. Go ahead and find it, the Futures game. 24s, 25s battling, and then of course tonight right back here on ESPNU, it's the High School All-American game. This is the face of the future of the sport, and this event captures it better than anybody else as the first pitch to Eileen Donahue. This is up and away, 1-0 the count. Skyla Wagner, the pitcher, the cybersecurity major with a minor in education when she goes to Jacksonville. Fun to hear athletes, and it doesn't matter if you don't, but some know exactly what they want to study right out of the gates, and I'm sure it's a pretty big challenge to play D1 softball, study cybersecurity with a minor, too.
Now, I love hearing the stories behind why they choose such specific areas of study. It's not just lawyer, doctor. It's something very specific, maybe a family trade, but she's somebody we'll all be calling in the future.
Isn't that the truth? She's trying to get Eileen Donahue out right now, the Chicago one. Goes to Marist High School right there in Chicago. This is a University of Illinois commit. Dangerous first baseman with a bat in her hands. Has called her summer this 2023, her graduate summer, amazing. She flips that one down off the end of the bat and it's foul. She said, it's been so unbelievable. This is my last summer on the Bandits. 9 years, my first time was a 10U team. She said, and these are her words, means everything, that this is how I get to end my career in this game. They are sisters, especially if you've been together for 9 years, some of them.
It's been really fun to see organizations that keep the same girls together for a very long period of time. You don't see it that often, especially when there are a lot of different travel ball organizations in one area. But in this case, the Bandits draw athletes and they keep them for a very long time.
Eileen, the daughter of Aaron and John Donahue. And she's the oldest with four younger siblings, as that one is just off the plate. That's a nice take as Wagner tried to entice. They played softball, basketball, volleyball, soccer, gymnastics, swimming, cheer. Did it all growing up. In basketball in high school, then it's kind of been focused into softball. Going to pay for a college education. Throws down on strikes. Went right back out there. Kind of doubled up on that same exact spot with effect.
Yeah, she's been really consistent on this corner, about belt high. Some good spin.
Designated player, number four, Annalee Adams.
Adams now takes her chance. Annalee, the Auburn commit. One more year of high school for her. Union County High School in Liberty, Indiana. Here we go. there. 0-1 the count. Adams with that homer, the 1-0 win over the Mojo yesterday. What a scene it was, too, by the way. Just the reaction, and you can imagine it. This time, got her down off the end of the bat. This is an easy play for Kirsten Stevens, the second baseman. Barber Park, Dana Manning Stadium. It's such a functional complex. You have multiple games going on throughout this championship week. Those fields to keep the main diamond pristine. Those are the workouts, pregame, the stretches, get the arms loose. And then you bring your gear and you hit it and go. Quite a scene, by the way, and you can see the walkway up on top of the chair backs when the teams walk in. Most athletes, especially at a younger age, aren't wanting to walk somewhere with everybody looking and staring at them. That's more of a walk of fame, though, in this case. And as you make the walk in, and the families and the fans, the college coaches turn and look, and you go down into the dugout. That's pretty well struck. The catcher, Liv Christopher. But Rasmussen is there, the right fielder. So far, so good. Both pitchers looking to set the tone, making it clear this may be our day today. Best softball players in North America have gathered. They will do so at the younger ages again next week at the 10, 12, and 14 U age groups. These are college-bound athletes in this game, almost every single one of them. As Katie Campbell gets the first pitch from Sage Marchetko in and off the plate, headed to Sanford up in Alabama. Katie's at Mariner High School in Cape Coral, Florida. She graduated summa cum laude. Boy, did she take care of her business as a student. Jennifer and Christopher, her parents, proud of what she did. She takes in and off the plate. Consider this, too. For the Rock Gold team, Fort Myers based, but a lot of Florida represented, northern portions of Florida. Think about Hurricane Ian. Since we saw this team last year, that just tore apart the west coast of Florida. And what these athletes, the fear these families have been through. It wasn't just beaches, it was homes, it was churches, and it was fields that were destroyed by Ian. As hurricane season starts again in Fort Myers, Florida, so there's some gut and heart they'll talk about that they went through.
Oh, absolutely. And then just an appreciation for being able to get back on the field and play the game.
How about that 2-1 pitch? Just a heavy drop ball at the plate on 2-1, and it got a swing like it was a no-ball, two-strike count. South Carolina commit. Ball, that's strike three. That's three strikeouts of the four outs she has put in the books. And a quick conversation, Katie, right away, talking with her teammate.
Yeah, it's a little, almost looks like a backdoor screw the way that Christopher set up behind the plate. The ball runs back in.
Megan Rasmussen
manages to get the swing and miss.
Megan Rasmussen out of Sunrise, Florida. Just graduated from Pembroke Pines Charter High School. Headed up to Jacksonville State University in Alabama, choosing Jack State, loved the family atmosphere. Intends to major in exercise science and wellness. Eric and Stephanie, her mom and dad, say goodbye to her as she heads off to her college journey. Over the shoulder of the leaders of this sport, just in the Midwest, but on a national level with what Bill Conroy has done with this Beverly Bandits program. There's a lot of wisdom to be had in conversations. Did Bill just give us a wave?
He did, he was saying
very
hi.
Presidential of him. The 1-1, elevated. Yeah, that's exactly right. It's funny, I was actually thinking that thought. We're on the same page. Now Walsh and I in the production truck, because There have been national championships at the 16U and 18U. I guess those don't get worn all the time, but collectively, I mean. But what a good day to wear them all.
Yeah.
There's that drop ball again with a little bit of spin to it, too. Almost had the look of a screwball at the plate.
Yeah, Marjeka throws so many spins on different planes that it's just hard to square up. This has that drop ball spin.
Designated player.
And it's not really too far in or out. It's pretty much over the heart of the plate, but just has tremendous break on it.
Conroy has coached national championship teams at PGF twice at the 16U age group, once at the 18U age group, as we told you that year, back in 2017. Sophia Kardatsky, the DP in this one. With precision, the count is evened up at 1-1. Spider is her nickname at University Christian School. She's got one more year, so a rising senior, as you saw, committed to South Carolina Upstate. One and two, the count.
Marjeko doesn't use it a whole lot, but when she does, it's really effective because, again, it looks identical to the drop ball with the spin and the break. Just that big speed differential.
Now a rise ball up and away, 2-2 the count against Kardatsky. Sophia, the daughter of Richard and Charlotte. Competitively, volleyball, soccer, weightlifting. Done them all and now zeroed in on softball. Electric stuff, appearing unhittable, as she was yesterday in this event when she spun a no-hitter. Paige Marjeko, the 18U Premier Division championship game. Oh, tell me, all the parents out there don't want to do that to their kids. He doesn't know. Oh, boy, he doesn't know. Seriously, Dad. Love that. All of us parents were born to do that as we get back to action. Emma Lotus, the right fielder. So far, the pitchers have established that it's their game. We'll see how it rolls on. It's been the minimum for the Bandits. Hit batter to open the game, then a double play as that one is rolled foul. It's been the minimum for Rock Gold. Is the only difference here, 5 of the 6 outs by Serge Marjeko have been strikeouts.
The pitchers have been on point. And it's the first time through the lineup still, so it's always interesting to see the adjustments that are made when you approach that second at bat.
And pitchers are cognizant of that, though.
Absolutely, and the good pitchers make adjustments on their end as well.
Lotus from New Lenox, Illinois, Central Michigan commit. Couple of hops, right back to the circle, spin, fire, and a Lotus. Recent graduate of St. Lawrence High School is erased on a 1-3 ground out that time.
Now batting,
Julia Larson,
third
out of St. Charles, 30. Illinois, will take her
Julia
turn now.
Larson.
She's in the Illinois State by way of St. Charles North High School. Not far from home. That was one of the reasons she wanted to stay somewhat close to family, Eric and Joy, her parents, the Larsons. 1-0 the count. This was an 8-year basketball player. Definitely, you'll hear with a lot of these athletes that it wasn't softball only until very recently. Some of them, just a select few, still play varsity sports, the other sports. Great ball gets a swing and a miss, 1-1 the count.
Do you find that more so in areas like the Midwest than in California, the multi-sports?
Thoughts?
I feel like we talk more about multi-sport athletes when we talk about teams like the Bandits. And
how long did you play soccer? When did you stop playing soccer?
When I graduated high school.
Okay,
so through
you played
high school,
this age. You were playing all the way until you went
and
to
volleyball.
UCLA.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Better for it?
I mean, I believe that I was, but also all of my coaches and all the sports and the high school programs, they gave way to each other, so it wasn't ever a conflict.
More good stuff and a strikeout. Soccer, volleyball, softball for you. That's a busy school year.
Hey, you're getting out of trouble, I guess.
Funny you were, and I'm going to share something you said. I don't know if you knew I'd share this with the audience, but you said when you were younger, you were, to use your word, kind of square, a nerd. And I think if you're going to play like these athletes are, though, there's no time, as you said, to find trouble. Your time's taken. That one is slashed, and it's down in the left field. That's Kernan Bailey. Bailey out of that nine hole comes up with a single, and this slapper with a pretty approach.
Yeah, how about the number nine coming in big time with this first base hit of the ball game?
Center fielder.
Just dropping it in the left field.
From Gahanna, Ohio, Kiernan. Heading to Dayton. She'll play on that Dayton Flyers softball team. On the move, throw down, not in time. Quick release by Katie Campbell, but a nice jump by the speedy Bailey.
Yeah, quick release here, but Bailey just gets her hand in just before the tag.
Career stolen base record at her high school, 153 bags in her career in high school. That one is outside, and the pressure is on now. Matter of fact, as Blackwell at the top of the order goes to work, Bailey this year set a school record for a single season as she stands out there. She stole 75 bases in a single season. That's three a game. Shallow center field charging. Making her look easy, Kylie Shaw. A mini threat, and I mean teeny tiny, but it's bubbling. We're heading into that second time through the order. 18U championship game scoreless. They're dancing everywhere. The youngsters. The dads, the one having fun on the berm. Glad to have you back with us, Amanda Freed, Darren Sutton, and the Premier Girls Fast Pitch 18U National Championship game. The Beverly Bandits from the Midwest, home base south side of Chicago, Fort Myers, Florida. Rock Gold Mineta, Johnny Mineta, their head coach. We'll hear from Johnny in the next half inning as the first pitch is high and tight to Kirsten Stevens. Stevens from Land O'Lakes, Florida, headed to Jacksonville University. She's got one more year of high school first. 1-1 the count. Samantha and Scott, her parents. AP classes on her resume just about the entire time, all through high school, while managing a 4.0. 2-1 the count. That pitch there, and she's used it different counts, it literally looks like it has a 25-pound dumbbell attached to it.
And that's what makes it so tough. It looks good, and it's heavy, and it's quick down in the zone.
Then she elevates like that.
And we've seen more of that as this game has gone on. She's starting to go waist high and above, and then complementing with that down pitch. But what I love is she throws this rise ball through the zone. So that's at the belt, it's not going at the eyes. If it's at the eyes, it's not even tempting because she's got such a good drop ball. But by keeping it down by the belt, it takes the hitter that split second longer to figure out if it's going up or down.
And then a take on a change of pace that time. Pretty wicked take, I might add, for Stevens.
After that big swing. Oh, good hold. Great pitch.
Houston here in the championship game. Meanwhile, her brother Evan at 13 is on his way to the Little League World Series. How about mom and dad with those nerves? That's coming back our way. South Carolina commit has worked the count full. Inside corner, Scooball, strike three. And the clinic continues. Six strikeouts up to seven outs.
Well, she's just been so unpredictable because she's got so many tools in her belt.
Number four, Jazz.
Right there, Stevens looking for a possible rise ball drop away. She's gotten that changeup, but then Marjenko finishes her off with a screwball.
Out of Punta Gorda, Florida, this is Jasmine Jones, or Jazz as she is known. She's in the hole 0-1. Stacy Paulson, by the way, is our home plate umpire. You can hear those clear calls of balls and strikes. Floated a changeup. 1-1 the count. Continuing to stir things up. It's hard for these hitters to find any sort of comfort. Jazz, the daughter of Julian James. Umpire Paulson looks on as the 1-1 ties up Jazz. Jones calls Johnny Mineta a huge inspiration. That he's coached me selflessly since I was 11 years old, helped me become a college softball player. If I can grow up and be as selfless as he is, then I've accomplished something. Really good pitch. There's that drop ball at the plate.
Yeah, it was one of those two-strike pitches where, as a pitcher, you fist pump because you executed, but unfortunately didn't get the call.
What's next, though? That's the key. Elevated, rise ball, thanks for coming. Seven strikeouts. Let's just take a peek at what we've seen. Seven of the eight outs, Amanda, have been strikeouts.
Yeah, this is just such a solid performance by Marjenko, and there's not one pitch that she's doing it with, and I think that that's what can confuse a batter, is she's used her screwball. She's heavily going down with that drop ball. It's got so much movement. She's going up in the zone. And she's complementing all that with her changeup. So as a hitter, you don't think that there's one out pitch that she's going to. She's used a number of them in different situations. Six straight strikeouts.
Seven overall. Julia Knoller flied out to right field back in the first inning. See, DeFato takes that one low.
I was just thinking in my head, I think it's about time to maybe try some short game. Just sometimes you just need to put the bat on the ball to get a little momentum in your dugout.
And they're thinking right along with you. There's no way they want to let that happen. Alexandra, or Lex DeFato as she is known, is from Pembroke Pines, Florida. West Broward High School, just graduated. On her way to South Carolina upstate. Said goodbye to her high school as a 4.5 GPA student. Lex would love to someday be, as her studies complete, a firefighter or a paramedic. Goes down with a wicked screwball. That is eight strikeouts up to nine outs through three innings. She threw a no-hitter on her way here. She's got that kind of stuff today. But we're just getting started in this scoreless championship game. Glad to welcome you back. Johnny Mineta is the head coach of this talented Rock Gold team out of Fort Myers, Florida, representing the state of Florida very, very well. Johnny, thanks for spending time with us. We appreciate it.
Thank you for having us.
I'd love to know how you go from winning platinum to building something so strong that you're right back here at the berth that you earned and playing again on the final day.
You know, it's been special. Most of these kids have been with me for, you know, many, many years. So, you know, we've believed in ourselves. We've believed in the program that we're building. And, you know, we're looking forward to the future, you know, and, coming back here every year.
So just a moment ago, I shared a thought of one of your players saying, my coach, and I believe it was Jazz Jones, saying, look, this is a man who's coached me for a long time in my life. I hope I can grow up to be half the person he is as a man and is selfless. When you hear your athletes speak of you that way, you didn't know they did it. They shared it with me. What does that mean?
Really?
Really.
Tremendous kids, tremendous work ethic. You know, they put everything they had into this, and, you know, they've done everything I've ever asked them to do. They've trusted the process. They're just great human beings.
And talk a little bit about the culture of the team during this tournament. You know, it's a grind to get to today. Talk a little bit about how proud you are of these athletes for what they've accomplished over this week.
Oh, man. You know, the roller coaster of the week. You know, behind in some games, having to come back. You know, getting out front and trying to keep the energy, trying to keep the pitchers healthy. You know, just the grind of, you know, playing 7 days in a row is taxing. They've done a great job. You know, they've eaten the right things while they've been here. You know, they've enjoyed being in California and being tourists at the same time, being prepared when they show up to the park. So, you know, I give it to them. You know, it's all on them.
Is In-N-Out Burger included in eating the right thing or no?
That's just me and my daughter. You know, my 10-year-old's here with me, and you know, yeah, we visited In-N-Out Burger, and yeah, it's maybe not so much on their diet, but it's on mine.
That's good. Hey, I'm with you all the time. I want to leave you with this, by the way, and just because I thought it was cool that we were having you on. It was your athlete, Jazz Jones, Jasmine. She said, and I quote, "Personally, my travel ball coach, Johnny Mineta, is my biggest inspiration. He's coached me selflessly since 11. Help me become the player I am today. If I can grow up to be as selfless as he is, I know I've at least accomplished something." Boss, best of luck to you the rest of the way. Boy, these impact you've had on these athletes. Super proud to talk to you.
Thank you very much.
Johnny Mineta, what a job he has done. And look, those emotions in part come from this. To me, you're already stressed, you're thrilled, you can't believe what you're going through, and then you hear your kids are talking about you that way.
Because you hope you make an impact on your athletes. I mean, you spend so much time, energy, effort. And these coaches talk about the human beings that they're trying to create, not just the best softball players. Yeah, you want to get them to that next level or whatever it is that they want to be, but it's about becoming great human beings. So when you actually hear that you are making that impact, it's got to be emotional. And I love how he did mention that they're tourists also, because
yes,
so much of the experience is about that. It's not just the game. It's coming out here to Huntington Beach, Southern California, and being a tourist and still being able to get it down on the field.
Yeah, you have to take advantage. By the way, Jazz Jones is the shortstop who shared those words. And when someone has the responsibility of your time away from home, your time away from the classroom, that's next on the list of someone you see the most. Boy, excellent stuff. I mean, right there, stride by stride, as much as we are seeing just about every out from Marchenko be a strikeout. An emotional game, certainly proud of his athletes. He hopes at some point those are tears of joy. The Beverly Bandits are Bill Conroy, and he is in turn the Beverly Bandits, coursing through and through this organization, and he's here on championship day. Bill, you've been here before. You have the rings and the hardware and the memory to prove it. How much does it mean to be here on this championship day again with these athletes?
Honestly, this is a great group of young ladies, and led by, you know, Sage in the circle there, and you know, it's been a great ride running with them for the last 3 years.
When you mentioned Sage, and I know collectively as a team they've been on point all week long, but Sage in the circle has been so effective, and I have my opinions on why, but you see her far more than I do, so in your opinion, what is it that makes Sage in the circle?
Well, she really has six pitches. So she can end up, you know, dominating with any one of them. Rise, drop, change, screw, curve, and a slow drop.
Talk to me a little bit about how you guys build from within in the Midwest, how proud you are to represent. Look, your program's one of the top-tier name brands in the PGF world, but how proud are you of Midwest softball that you've helped build?
Well, I am very proud of it. We got two kids on this team that have been with me for 9 years. Our shortstop, Gabby Comilla, and Eileen Donahue started when they were 9 years old. So, love seeing what has happened with the Midwest since I've been involved in the late 90s. And now we're as dominant as any region in the country.
Yeah, and on the other side, having to deal with Skylar Wagner, I love your thoughts, because as much as Sage has been a handful, so has Skylar for you guys. Your thoughts on what you're seeing in the circle?
She's our kryptonite, a lefty that's very crafty. We have our hands full. All we need to do is scratch one or two, and with Sage on the mound, I feel pretty good, but we have to get some base runners.
You got her one yesterday, and that was enough in the game in which you threw a no-no. Bill, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Number 21, Julia Noller.
And here's Julia Noller. I'm talking ball with Bill. That's a voice that's done a lot of coaching this week. There's not a lot left in it. He needs to rest it soon.
Yeah, these coaches, they are taxed after this week. But, you know, he pretty much nailed it with Sage. We're on the same page. As, you know, a lot of pitchers have one out pitch or two out pitches where a hitter can really sit on that pitch. You get surprised if you have another one that gets you. But with Marjeko, it could be any one of her six pitches.
So while we were chatting, strikeout number nine. Nine strikeouts of the 10 outs thus far in this game. Julia flied out to right field. We're starting to celebrate her accomplishment at this point, because it was contact, and by the way, it was pretty solid contact that sent Lotus just shy of the wall. Straightens her up. 2-1 the count. Beverly Bandits, Beverly, south side of Chicago. Athletes from certainly Illinois, but Indiana. We've talked about Wisconsin, Ohio. These athletes commute to be a part of this Midwest program, this Midwest juggernaut. Bouncing ball, going to be tough. It finds its way into center field. And it's been Julia that has it figured out. Contact twice, the only one that has put a ball in play, a fly out, and now a single.
Yeah, how about that? Sometimes you just have a beat on a pitcher, and Noller, great job of just breathing a little life into her offense. It's hard when you see strikeout after strikeout, but to have one of your athletes, one of your teammates go up and get a base hit to get things going, it makes you feel like, okay, we're in this, we got a chance.
And now Cassidy Pont Bryant, the first baseman, Auburndale, Florida native. Plays first and pitches as well, and she's in the hole 0-1. High school graduate with high honors and a 3.9 GPA. A lot of in-classroom work as a teacher. Already learning a ton about education on the volunteer side. A lot of school hours. That one misses outside. She like you, there's Ralph Weekly looking on. Karen sitting right next to the legendary coaching duo. Now Karen running that program at Tennessee.
Yeah, Ralph's been around the game, and Karen. But Ralph goes way back with that.
You played for him at some point.
With him, gosh, when I was back in high school, just getting started in the national team program. He's given so much back to the sport, both at the international level and the collegiate level.
Two and two the count. Now this 18U game, you don't see quite as many coaches. The 16U game, but the Weekly's still taking this one in. 16U game had full conferences represented. And up and down the coast of California. Kind of a who's who. They're gonna miss. Runner on the move, throw down. Just trying to roll the dice. That's a strikeout. That's 10 strikeouts but you put yourself at least in a position, if you're Knoller and her team, where a single could give them the lead.
And I think that's what Rockgold needs, is just get that runner in scoring position and hope you come up with that clutch base hit.
Katie Campbell just graduated from Mariner High School in Cape Coral, Florida. Pitch in. Hey, the founder, president, and CEO of Premier Girls Fast Pitch will be joining us in the next half inning. Love our conversations because we learn a ton about the passion behind an event like this. Bouncing ball towards center field. Could be close to throw the plate. Is not in time! That's why you steal a base! The two-out RBI, Rockgold on top, 1-0.
Talk about clutch base hits. I mean, there are base hits in the right situations when your team's generating a lot of offense, but not in this ball game, not with the amount of strikeouts Marjeko's been throwing. Contact hasn't even been made, and now here we are, two base hits. No better time, but stolen base. I mean, that's going to go down as one of the best coaching decisions ever made by Coach Panetta to get that runner into scoring position. Because the way these two pitchers are throwing, you really do feel like it could be a one-run ball.
You bet. Johnny Manetta taking a chance. Reese Wells, by the way, is running out at first. Wells from Winter Haven, Florida, another Jacksonville University commit. Just graduated from Winter Haven High School. Right back to work, strike one, upper tier of that strike zone to Megan Rasmussen. Megan struck out back in the second inning. If you're just joining us, it's 10 strikeouts thus far for Sage Marjeko in the circle. 10, and we're here in the fourth inning. And that is the epitome of little ball. Bouncing ball single, a stolen base during a strikeout, and then another bouncing ball single. One and two, the count, good 0-2 pitch to Megan. The 1-2 from Sage. Rolls her with a changeup. Beautiful pitch. That is 11 strikeouts, but one big hit from Katie Campbell. These athletes from the west coast of Florida. Oh, Rockgold. 1-0 is the score. What a celebration of softball, and on this great championship and All-American Day, Dan Hay, the president and CEO of Premier Girls Fast Pitch, joins us upstairs. Dan, 2010 was the first year you guys rolled this out and kind of changed the face of softball. As we gather here today and tonight, the great All-American Games, Futures, and then High School Games, how proud are you of all the athletes, families, and your team as they've built this now, starting in 2010?
Well, it's grown from the two age groups to 9 different age groups. We had over 325 teams in here this week, and they all go home today, and we got another 300 teams flying in tonight to play the 14s, 12s, and 10 and unders championships for next week. So.
Your brainchild, this high school All-American game, kind of saying goodbye to high school softball, celebrating those that are going on the campus, and then the Futures game, which came right behind it. what a week it's been with those athletes because, again, they play with their travel teams and then they put on the PGF uniform.
Yeah, we started with the senior All-American game about 5 years ago, and we thought it was time to honor those kids that had been playing PGF for 5 or 6 years and made it to the pinnacle of the All-American game. And a couple years ago, we thought, let's start getting the top sophomores and top juniors together. So we started the Futures game. So that's, we're excited. In about a couple hours, we're going to be putting the top sophomores in the country versus the top juniors in the country from all over the United States, east to west, basically. And it should be fun.
Love it.
Well, what's really cool is that we talk to a lot of these athletes who are just joining the Futures All-American Games and the Senior All-American Games, and they've seen it on TV and thought, man, I really want to be a part of that. And it becomes a goal and something they want to continue to stay in. But talk a little bit about how we spoiled those athletes this, this whole week. They've had such a great time, but I mean, you really go above and beyond to make the families feel celebrated.
Yes, the seniors get to go on a luxury yacht in Newport Harbor, them and their families. We allow them to invite two family members, and we had about 150 people on the boat. We give them their gear. They get spoiled. We feed them lunch, and they get to travel through the beautiful Newport Beach harbor there for 4 hours and just enjoy themselves, and they have a blast. You see, they were playing games, and we had some type of nitro ice cream guy on there.
That was cool.
A big hit. Yeah, yeah. So
some action on the base pads. The pinch runner, there they are, sporting their Futures uniforms, hoping to be a part of the high school All-American game. These Bandits with something going. Adam seeks a pinch runner. Liv Christopher now will hit in this game, this nail-biting 1-0 championship game. I think what's fun, too, is when she and I, Amanda and I, call college games. You know, we broadcast college games. And you start doing your research, you always find it easy to have these athletes, once they go to college, refer back to these weekends. They love them. They cherish this chance. Whether it be, Dan, the All-American, or just playing with their team, they really look back fondly.
They absolutely love the PGF National Championships and playing PGF across the United States. We've got regional and state directors across the country, and there's pretty much a Premier Girls Fast Pitch tournament going on in someone's neighborhood about every weekend. So it's become quite a brand, and we're very proud of it. We've got some phenomenal people here on the ground that makes this championship work. And I want to put a shout out to our umpires. We got some of the best umpires in the country. And we don't have a problem finding umpires. We hear that there's issues all the time, but they seem to come and want to work here. And we've got 50 NCAA umpires out here making sure these championships are as professional as possible. And that's pretty unheard of. And all of our local umpires, too. It's fantastic. They come from all over.
You brought me into the umpires' room the other night. That was kind of an honor. That's a group that doesn't mess around. I think what's cool is college softball technically is the highest and best level. If you really think about it, all the pros look to figure out where they're headed. And you're right. I talked to many of the umpires, not only that night with you, but this is a destination. It becomes a little bit of an umpire convention for the best umpires in the country.
We only have one prerequisite, and that's to make sure they have cataract surgery before they come and umpire our tournament.
I'm going to write that one down. I'll use that one for tomorrow night. Got to write that one down. So how proud are you of this legacy? And it's not just college softball players. It's women. It's professional women. It's those that now, when you have an event that's 14 years old and you're running it that long, you're having moms come to you and say, hey, I remember. How proud are you that legacy is growing now?
Well, Jocelyn Allo is a perfect example. She had a phenomenal career at Oklahoma and is now the home run queen of all-time history. Played PGF, played for myself and the Bat Busters and the other top coaches we had on that team and the late Mark Campbell. So we've got athletes like that all over the country that are going out and doing some great things in life, and that they cherish their PGF experience. They talk about it all the time.
And then this next wave that comes in from the 10s to the 12s to the 14s, an opportunity that maybe feels a little bit more grassroots, yet even when that's hit on the line, unable to get that double play. Even when you guys started the tenure a couple of years back, the level of play at that age group is amazing. They're charming to watch, but the level of play is great. This next weekend is so much fun.
Oh, absolutely. Sometimes our 10 and under game that we do is the most exciting game of the entire 2 weeks.
I would agree.
For some reason, it's the least amount of kids in the country that are playing in that age group, but whoever gets to those championship games, those 10 and under kids play like they're 18, but they're only about 2 feet tall, and they run like a bunch of little, you know, animals or around the bases. So.
Popped up left side. She got out of that mess. Thank you, my friend.
Okay.
And hey, we appreciate you providing this opportunity.
You guys do a great job as always. Thank you.
BGF National Championship. 1-0. Rock Gold on top. Want to thank Dan Hay for spending time with us. That makes you, I think, maybe a little bit more wise to how things work here in the thought process of a California-built tournament that is a North America tournament. And a coach of this sport, he's done many things successfully as an entrepreneur in his life, but a passionate coach of this sport, Dan Hay. Not always will you find the CEO of something this impactful, this large, which proves to be a springboard to college softball that still is out there coaching.
Yeah, because he loves the game and he's very good at the game and has a lot of knowledge still to share. And I think being involved in the game helps him create a bigger, better event.
Firm spin to that curveball over the outside corner for a strike. It is 11 strikeouts as we play here in the bottom of the fifth inning. For Sage Marchenko, a South Carolina commit. To the right side, picked on something up out over the plate, and it's a single. Is that a changeup? We'll look and see.
I don't think it was a changeup. It looked like it might have been a curve on the outside.
You're exactly
the curve
right.
Stays high, but I mean, that's not even a bad pitch. That pitch is out of the zone, but look at the approach and the hands to just go with this ball to the right side and hits it hard.
Kardatsky with the single. She had struck out back in the second inning. Johnny Mineta pulls his offense together. Meantime, a quick meeting in the circle. Bill Conroy, who runs this Bandits program, said it clearly. We need a couple. They do need a couple now. Would be more than enough. And I'll talk about what is golden for the Rock Gold. Even just one more run, it feels like it's a million miles away when you're facing a pitcher like this one. But you just took one small step closer.
Yep.
This is when she thrives, though. They take chances on the bases. Infield very tight in the corners in this 1-0 game. Snap throw down to first after a screwball missed up and in to Stevens.
So it looks like Rock Gold is playing for that one run, showing the sacrifice bunt. Trying to do what they did last time, do whatever it takes to get that runner in scoring position.
Split the plate with that one. One and one, the count. Liv Christopher does not, and I repeat, does not want Sophia Kardatsky to get comfortable at first at all. Maybe take some of the wind out of her sails, having her dive back over and over. Stevens. One hop, only plays to first, and a great jump, by the way. There wasn't even a consideration to turn and throw. Good choice by Larson. She made the right choice, but it was a huge jump by Kardatsky.
Oh, yeah, and look at how close Larson is playing up that line. She gets this really quickly, but she knows it's most important to get that out at first.
Wasn't even a hesitation. Take that sure out. When you have a pitcher like this one, like Sage, working in front of you, take the outs. Another bunt. Take the outs. The runner moves to third. I'm thinking if you're Sage, too, you just thank them. Tip your mask there that you have on, just tip it to the other side and say, okay, that's three or four or five less pitches I just had to throw. The way she just handled it. Lexi DeFato struck out back in the third inning. Lexi does have a chance, though, with the single to really make things fun. 0-1 the count.
According to her coaches, she's got some ridiculous speed. So sometimes just putting that ball in play, getting down the line, you'll see these slappers coming through in big time situations with runners on third.
Boy, are they tight, even in the middle. I mean, they're right on top of her on the corners, but the middle is very tight. She thinks about it, pops it up. Diving play! Eileen Donahue leaves her feet under that dirt surface. No way, no how. Not the way Sage is pitching. Am I about to let this ball in? Oh, you betcha. Feels like a title game, doesn't it? PGF 18U. More chances for the Midwest-based Beverly Bandits as they trail it by a score of 1-0. As great as Sage Marchetko has been, Skylar Wagner has been right there with her. Maybe not quite as dominating via the strikeout, but a zero and just one hit allowed. And there's a base hit to start the inning. That's a 2-for-2 afternoon on Championship Saturday for Kieran Bailey.
And that number 9 spot has done well for her, turning it over to the top. Just takes that pitch with her, drives it into right field.
Strategy time and a gathering to talk it over. Blackwell, Meredith, all in front of one of the better players in the nation in the class of 2024, Gabby Comia, who is waiting in the hole to hit. What are you thinking? Be a coach down there for me for the Bandits.
Well, you need two to win this game, but are you playing for the one? And I think it's just, hey, let's think about what we're trying to accomplish here. You know, don't get out of your shoes in this at bat. The main priority is to get that runner over to second base if you happen to get on. That's a bonus, but I think the Bandits are really good on the bases too, you know, so reminding the base runners, always looking for that next bag.
All right, come on, let's go.
I can see them using some speed to try to make things happen.
I'm going to look back here, and I'm just not going to watch.
Well, speaking of speed, Bailey's got a ton of it. She did pick up a stolen base. We talked about how many records she set throughout her time before graduating.
Number 21.
And here's Lila Blackwell, hit by a pitch, also fly to center field. Wagner, who Conroy called her our kryptonite with the way she deals. Not afraid to spin, change speeds, and to do it all from the left side. Blackwell drops that one down, right out of the circle. Fire is firm, and I mean a good, quick zip there from Wagner. In time for the out, runner moves to second. Well, if she hesitates for 1 minute, she's on.
Yeah, she was quick to that ball, and out of that lefty spins and throws a strike.
Wow.
That's just in time.
Dan Cohen on the call there, and a very good call. They're going to talk it over. By the way, as they get together, it's Steve Wenner, Davis Nixick, Stacy Paulson, our umpiring team. They're going to take a look. Unless I see something different. Paulson, Cohen, Wenner, and Nixick. Along with the help of technology, they're going to uphold this call. That's an out. Give Dan Cohen credit initially. He got that one right with the naked eye.
That was a tough play. Yeah, bang, bang. Might have been a little deceiving because of where the ball was caught.
Yeah. That didn't take long.
It didn't, yeah.
As they review that one. Call is upheld. Stacy Paulson comes out, lets everybody know. So with regard to challenges, that's all now for the remainder of whatever is left of this game for the Beverly Bandits.
But this might also be the Bandits' best opportunity at scoring runs. There's a big difference between a runner on second base and an out and two runners on, no out. So I think it was worth the challenge.
Well, again, we always consider and play the results. There's no monitor down there. There's no replay. You're just going what you saw with your naked eye as a coach and a staff. Like even when you look at as the first pitch is strike one, professional baseball at the highest of levels, they've got people looking at monitors, hopping on telephones. There's no guesswork involved. This is organic when you spend that replay challenge. And not a bad one, I agree. Drops down a bunt, but drops it down foul. Streaking up the line, Callie Meredith. Meredith 0 for 2 in this contest. Kekana, Wisconsin. Kekana High School. They play college baseball at Wisconsin Stevens Point. Good 0-2 pitch, it misses high. Part of the journey for Callie athletically has been unique because she played basketball, helped her a lot as a softball player, she said, but also figure skated very competitively for many, many years. Takes that one right there up the line on a check swing. There is no play. Takes an aggressive turn, heading into second. The tag, safe! Aggression, didn't miss a beat, like a safecracker out there. What made her think to do that?
Well, she just never stopped running cleanly through first base, and she knows it, so just takes off, keeping her eye on the ball to make sure she doesn't run herself into an out.
I think she thought that was thrown away. I really do. I think she thought that that ball was thrown down the right field line.
And had to find it?
I think she did. I really think that she saw her dugout react. They went crazy right out of the gates. I think she thought it was thrown into the right field corner. There's no way that she had intent on doing that. Let's do the reaction here. She hears that cheer. What do you think?
I mean, she's looking around. It looks like she's looking for the ball. I think she heard a go and, yeah, possibly assumed it was overthrown.
Wow. Nothing like a bunt double. Boy, talk about coming up bases and doing so in front of one of the best hitters in the country in this class. The Florida commit, Gabby Comian. Gabby's 0 for 2, has been held at bay. Boy, infield tight. And think what you do to a hitter like this, playing that infield so tight. You add 100 or 200. Keep adding whatever number you want to that already high batting average. With a bat handler like this. Wagner tries to react in the circle. Bouncing ball into center field, through the ground and infield. The throw is high. It's grabbed the lead. Gabby keeps on running. Hit first slide into third.
action, likes, drives it up the middle, and there's no shot or no chance that Meredith's going to stop at third. She is wheels all the way home, round in third. And same with Komiya. She does not stop stride, even though that ball's overthrown. She's not taking anything less than third base.
You could feel that moment building. Zoe Isagiri is called into the circle. Skylar Wagner was so good in this game, so important for her team, but we'll hand things off now. And now, of course, in this setting, you have Sage Marchenko. As Bill Conroy said, we just need to get her a couple of runs. Well, they've gotten those couple of runs, and they lead it 2-1. Zoe Isagiri is from Lehigh Acres, Florida, is a 2024. She's at Evangelical Christian School. They're hoping to find a place to play, making her decisions as a 24 for college softball, the daughter of Zeke and Tammy. Boy, that was a moment. Not only was it a moment that was set up, but then she delivered.
That's what those games are all about, is coming up with opportunities. And they've been hard to come by this game on both sides, but runners in scoring position and just coming up clutch.
Katie Campbell looks out. Says it very simple. Great capture there to Isagiri. Right here, me and you.
Conroy going for the squeeze on the first pitch.
Eileen Donahue is 0 for 2. Struck out a couple of times. Isagiri sails that one high. Talking about her stuff, she takes pride in her spin. These are her words. She loves throwing curveballs, screwballs, and rises. Changeup has improved quite a bit this summer. Bunted, bobbled, everybody's safe. 3-1.
Do is crack the door for the Bandits, because they are so aggressive on the base paths. Komiya is more than halfway down the line when contact's made, so you have to rush. And I don't think, even if Pump Bryant would have fielded that cleanly, that she would have had a shot at home.
No. No, the only play was behind her. Amazing base running. You and I had her on our PGF podcast. She's a little more dialed up now than she was when we interviewed her. What a fun athlete. Go find that interview. Amanda and I love doing it. Into center field. That ball was smoked. Adams, who homered yesterday, scorches one into center field here today. Jalen Salas is running, by the way, on to second base.
That's a great stroke.
There's the news of the day in print form, if you will. Pencil to paper, line drive, right field, that's down for a base hit. Liv Christopher out at the plate on the relay. They've been gambling this whole inning, really aggressive on the base pads. It got them that time. Maybe too aggressive, especially with the chance with just one out and the bases loaded.
Yeah, I think Bill Conroy knows, though, it only takes one, maybe, I mean, two is a pretty good cushion when you've got Marchenko in the circle, so he's gonna try to risk getting one more. You got those trail runners, so now you still do have a runner at third base. Right,
Boy, what a great tag.
Right there on the helmet.
What a great play by Katie Campbell with that tag.
Courtesy runner, number 42, Madison Patrick.
Madison Patrick will run. Seeing the play all the way through to completion. Not letting it sap your energy, your heart, your effort. And that's exactly what happens. And that turns out, well, when you're only down two, although you're dealing with an ace.
Number 11, Emma Lewis.
May turn out to be, we'll see, that may turn out to be a huge out and a huge play. Rock Golden, two more shots at it. Emma is grounded out and lined out to the first baseman. Screwball. That's the outside corner. Bill Conroy, as a head coach, has won this PGF championship three times. Twice at the 16U age group. Once at the 18U age group. Well, was that some pure passion from Gabby when she scored on that play?
She was a little excited. I mean, this team has just been plugging away, and you just had a feeling it was going to be a matter of time before they were able to really unleash their game, because they haven't been on the base paths, and that's really such a big part of the Bandits game, is what they're able to do on the bases.
Rock Gold, in the meantime, trying to keep it here at 3-1. They'll go back to the top of the order, and it will be the third time through dealing with Sage Marchenko. Elevated that time, down on strikes. But a big inning for the Bandits. They took their All-American, they put the bat in her hands, gave her a chance to drive in key runs and score a big one. And Gabby did it all. Trying to take it all the way to the finish line out of the heartbeat of America in the south side of Chicago. Those Beverly Bandits on top of the Fort Myers-based Florida Rock Gold Mineta. And now you, as if it's a relay race, hand the baton to Sage Marchenko. She is not only out of the gates the starting runner in this relay race, she also runs the final lap. Kylie Shaw is who she deals with first. It's back again, third time through. Shaw struck out twice. 11 strikeouts for this hurler. Two and oh.
In the last couple of innings, Rock Gold has really started to figure out a piece of Sage Marchenko, putting the ball in play more often. Obviously scoring a run, getting a couple of base hits.
Stacy Paulson steps out from behind home plate, deliberately stops play. And now back to work at 2-0. Sage sees it, shot wet, back past her into center field for a base hit. Shaw had been owned. I mean, absolutely dominated. Not that time, that's a single.
And again, just that momentum after you start to get some good bat on the ball. You start to believe, and I think this Rock Gold team now really does believe that they can get some base hits, get runners on, score a couple of runs, and they're still in this ballgame.
Julia Knoller singled, stole the base and scored, also fly to right field in her first at bat. Takes a screwball that misses outside. 1-0 the count. 1, 2, and 3 in the order this inning to start things. Sage elevates, it's popped up, foul territory, up against the opposing dugout. That's a fine play by Larson. Really drifting. Played it like it's her home ballpark.
Yeah, has that hand out to find the fence, but keeps her eye on the ball the whole time.
First baseman, number 11, Cassidy Punk Bryant.
Cassidy Pont Bryant takes low. Cassidy's mom, Krista, played travel softball, went to college, went on to play at the higher levels, also volleyball at Polk State College in Florida. Volleyball and softball player for mom. Shot, base hit right field. Now you've got the tying runs on. How about an aggressive first to third? But then a little bit too aggressive. We've got a rundown. To the plate. The tag was missed at second. Everybody safe. The tag was missed at second. And remember, for Bill Conroy, there are no more reviews. He can ask the umpires to talk about it. And they'll get together.
Well, sits back on this changeup first off and smashes it into the right field. And then it looks like Pump Bryant gets caught up in the rundown. I don't know, that's a tough one. That tag was attempted so quickly and then the runner took off for home. But does it get her?
Looked like it might have grazed her on the backside.
I agree.
But the one replay opportunity, the review was already used. Bang, bang, play. And one more time. She got her right there. You can see the glove give. That was the key. She's in scoring position now. Cassidy with a beautiful swing of the bat. And this is a pitcher that has struck out 11. She struck out 11 through four innings. All the outs, but one were strikeouts. Again, maybe a little bit too overly aggressive last half inning by the Bandits. When you have a game now that's shifted gears, you look back on it. You hoped you wouldn't. Reese Wells runs for Rock Gold. Katie Campbell now in this 3-2 game. What an 18-year premier championship this has been.
Yeah, this has been fun.
Wow, Amanda. And all our viewers.
Katie Campbell was the one that came through with that clutch RBI single to get things going back in the fourth.
Think about, if you don't mind, Gabby Comia, who did all that last inning, coming up with the big hit, scoring on the squeeze play, the yell as she came through and threw her arms by her side. She's playing in the next game. She's playing in the Futures All-American game. She will sleep well tonight.
Yes.
Oh, that got her. Got her, looked like right below the knee, and that doesn't feel good. She's hobbling, trying to get moving. A couple of runners on now. Campbell, the catcher, they're used to being beat up just a little bit, but boy, that scored her up right in the knee. Goodness. I would imagine one to make sure that knee's okay, plus the fact this is your catcher, you can have a courtesy runner, and they will do so. As she jogs off and gives way to Lexi Fitzgerald. Lexi will run.
First, number six, Lexi Fitzgerald.
Lexi out of Punta Gorda, Florida, Charlotte High School, heading into her senior year. She'll play for Coach Dan Anthony this year. Daughter Michelle and Todd. Fitzgerald runs it first. The go-ahead run at first. Megan Rasmussen now with a couple of runners on. One out in the inning. struck out twice. She was strikeout victim number 11, as a matter of fact. One and one.
I love the adjustments that Rock Gold has been making. A couple of strikeouts for Shaw, then the base hit. A couple of strikeouts for Pump Bryant, a base hit.
The 1-1 to the Jack State commit is hit hard. Toward the hole, base hit right field. Lotus charges. They send the runner to the plate. The tag out at the plate. The call is out at the plate. Stacy Paulson makes the call. Emma Lotus made a beautiful throw to Liv Christopher.
And a base hit, a couple strikeouts, and then coming through in a clutch situation. Look at this throw on target. A very close play, and it looks like the umpires have come together, discuss.
Boy, that's going to be a really interesting review. That left hand is the key. Clearly tagged her.
Oh, that's tough. I don't know that there's enough to reverse it. I think that could have gone either way.
That's difficult to see. Maybe this angle tells a different story. I mean, you could overturn it.
Yeah.
You could call her safe to tie the game. Hand there. Looks like the hand's in that back corner. And there's the tag, right? The hand, you can see it easing in. Hand's not there yet. The tag's not there yet either. Tag's not there yet. Hand's there. Boy, that's close. Now there's the tag. You could overturn that one. But again, it's such an amazingly difficult call. We'll see what they decide. Tough to tell that time.
Fingers are definitely over the plate.
Yeah, look like she got the, you can see the, right the bottom corner that she's on it, and then immediately thereafter the tag is there.
That's what ESPN say. It looks like the hand is in the back corner. We're gonna go with one.
Yeah, look like she got that back corner ahead of the tag. I say that with not a lot of decisiveness. There she's on. I think she just gets in ahead. I think she just got in ahead.
This is gonna be a very dramatic overturn if that's the decision.
Now they're still discussing it. What a beautiful slide, by the way. Paulson continues the conversation with the review team.
A lot of pressure with all those athletes looking on, anxiously awaiting. This is why coaches save those challenges for late in the ball game, because this really could be a difference maker.
It's just so tough to tell. Is it by a pinky finger? Is it on the corner? That's the key. Stacy comes out. She has the word. Safe is the call. The game is tied. What a beautiful slide at home plate to avoid that tag.
Wow. I mean, it could not have been any closer than that.
And that's why technology is a wonderful part of this event to add to it. These umpires do such an incredible job. Think about what a great call Stacy makes in that situation, how difficult that is with the naked eye, and how the replay team had to angle after angle after angle after angle to finally find that she got the corner, then the tag came down.
Look at how quickly this happens in real time.
I think that's exactly what I would have called too, by the way. Intentional walk, by the way, Karnatsky. She was intentionally walked to load the bases for Kirsten Stevens. Infield way in. She had squared the bunt. Aggressive, the throw is high, though. And right back in there. Boy, everybody off the bag aggressively. That's a nice heads-up pounce as Meredith came sprinting in to play it on a hop.
Oh, man, that was a missed squeeze. Then overthrow, it almost works. Here's off the base everywhere, a lot of confusion.
Defense readies themselves tight, I mean way in. Inside with a screwball. About Sage out there just in the trenches battling right now. Third time through, she's had an amazing game. Still has every shot in the world to be the winning pitcher in this one. She's been great. But they've found just a little bit more about her. And you've got to give credit to Rock Gold because, honestly, like, the concept of losing confidence or being dejected, it was all out there in front of them. Everyone was striking out every at-bat.
Everybody was. So it's easy, yeah, to feel defeated and feel like you don't have a chance at this game. But for them to go in and make adjustments, which the best athletes do, just to start to plug away.
Swing and a miss right over the top of that one. One and two the count, bases full. Just spoiled it at the very last minute. Kirsten had a sack bunt last inning, struck out looking in the third inning. Bouncing ball toward that hole. The play is to the plate in time. Way to execute if you're in fact the Bandits. Of course, we've come to expect that from Gabby Comia. But she fires a strike nonetheless to Liv Christopher. Big out.
Yeah, goes in the hole, smothers this, and then fires a strike without a step home.
She's a cool customer.
She is.
Number four, Jazz Jones.
Jazz Jones now with the chance to be a hero. Stevens reaches on the fielder's choice. Jazz struck out, had a sack bunt. Jones, pretty good hack on a pitch up in the zone. Rock Gold Mineta at the 18U age group. In the Platinum Division last year, the lower tier, they won it all. They're back again in the Premier. What a scrappy bunch. Bouncing ball, slips into center field. One runner score. The throw to the plate. Two runs come in. Rock Gold jumps on top by a pair. Jazz Jones gets it done.
I mean, just delivering when they need it the most. Rock Gold has completely answered back in this inning. Jazz Jones, a little base hit up the middle, and that's really what this team has been about. It hasn't been the long ball. We haven't seen any gap hits. Nothing's hit the fence. Everything is just quick up the middle, quick in a hole, and it's worked out beautifully.
gap hits. We didn't see contact for an hour.
Contact was difficult at the beginning of the game, but gosh, the adjustments being made and the clutch performing at the plate.
Right back to the screen. Remember, it was the words of Jazz Jones earlier in this game that made her big, tough, strong head coach, Johnny Mineta, cry during our interview. I think she just made him cry again with that hit. Tears of joy. That one's up and away. Now, Johnny knows, and his team knows, and as my college baseball coach used to say, don't pack the bats just yet. These bandits, not at all intimidating in settings like this being down. 1-2 the count. Faith Wharton gets the call. This is a great chance for Faith to hit. First at bat in this game. What a single would mean for Faith and her team. Comes up empty that time, the USC upstate commit. But her teammates, incredible against one of the better pitchers in the land at this age group in Sage Marjeko. One overturned call, a couple of real timely hits, and a bunch of emotions. 5-3 the number as we head to the seventh. On to the final frame, maybe. The way this game has gone, we're not so sure. How about that four spot for Rockgold and so many twists and turns? Unable to use a replay on what looked like would have been a tag out at second base, which would have changed this inning. The Bandits had used it earlier. Rockgold with the use of a replay left, using it, and an ever so close play at the plate, overturned, tying the game. And then a shortstop making just enough contact to hit a ground ball through after a bases loaded walk. In front of her. Out of the gates, popped up, communication, pretty well done. One pitch, one out, you love that. If in fact you're Rockgold. And pops up to the left fielder. Kiernan Bailey has been really good in this bottom spot. Let's see if she can get something going. Second baseman. The Midwestern juggernauts, the Bandits. Lisa Gary fires outside. Zoe turns out to be a big story as she comes in and restores order as they have gotten to Skylar Wagner. Just her presence. There was that moment where Katie Campbell just said when it looked like things would go off the cliff in the Bandits' favor. Just me and you. Just me and you, her catcher said to her. One step closer. Bailey, my goodness. Talk about stepping up on Championship Saturday.
Three for three. A little piece of hit into each of the three outfield positions. This one right back up to center field.
So you got Virginia Tech commit Lila Blackwell. Who this year in her senior year hit 546 at Roncalli High School. On base at a 580 clip, which means she brought a bat and she swung and only walked eight times. Aggressive hitter. Joe's bunt. High pop, left field, another good communication. Waving, saying, I got it, that softball is mine. And that's exactly what Kardatsky did as she makes the play for the second out of the inning. One out away from what will be an improbable title and back-to-back years in which they have brought the hardware back to Florida. Callie Meredith. She doubled and scored in her last at bat. One and one the count.
And Everyone's pinched in for Meredith. Outfield about middle depth. The infield just trying to cut down on anything small in the infield. Have the dangerous Kumia on deck.
Tries to take the bunt with the Isagiri out of the circle. Yeah. Oh, champion! Rocked on for the second consecutive year. Comes to California. Brings that hardware back to Florida. In the year 2023, Rock Gold Momentum. The PGF Premier Division 18U National Champs. Here come some of those tears of joy. Back-to-back years, they won the platinum. They earned the right to just play in this event. That's all you earn with the platinum, just you can play in the premier. And they won the premier.
And this event is so much about grit and determination and, you know, and putting it together on the field. And this team absolutely brought their A game. But let's talk about this game as a whole and the direction it went, the dominance that both starting pitchers showed, and the adjustments made at the plate. Ultimately, Rock Gold comes out on top. But what a phenomenal performance by the Beverly Bandits. This is really, these are the moments that you look forward to. This is just the epitome of what these tournaments are about. And this is the highest quality softball in ETU.
And between last year's title and this year's title, many of them dealing with areas of Florida being ravaged by Hurricane Ian. And we're gonna have a chance to talk with, there's so many heroes, but Jazz Jones certainly was one of them. Jones was just a clutch piece of hitting, and Jazz spends time with us now. Jazz, 9 years you've been with this program. They've changed your life, what you've been able to do. How much did it mean to be able to deliver that hit?
It honestly meant so much to me. Being a part of this team and being able to be the reason that we won it, you know, once again. And it's for the ending, it's for the best of everything. Makes me really happy.
And talk about your team's performance throughout this week. You know, this is about the grind. It's about determination. It's about playing together, selfless softball. Talk about how proud you are of your group for accomplishing this today.
I'm so proud of my team. We always talk about how we play for each other. We never fail to do that. And that's what keeps us in big tournaments like this. That's what helps us win tournaments like this. I love them.
So, Jazz, I don't know if you know this because you were busy playing, but earlier in the game, I told Johnny what you said about him, that he is someone that inspires you. He cried. He literally cried like you are now on live TV in the middle of it all. How much does that man mean to you as you now go off to play college softball?
He means so much to me. He's one person that will always be in the front of my mind, always in the back of my mind when I'm on this softball field. He's taught me everything I know. He's helped me get to college. I couldn't ask for a better coach or a better man just to be in my life.
Jazz, you're clutch. You know that, right? I mean, that's clutch, Jazz. That's clutch what you did. Congratulations, Jazz Jones. What a moment for Jazz and the Rock Gold coming up clutch. You get those moments very rarely in your life, and to come through, that's amazing, Amanda.
Yeah, and she'll remember this for her entire life. I mean, past far beyond what softball is over, she's going to remember moments like this and being able to come up and perform on the biggest stage. Just so proud of that team for what they were able to do.
Just talk about the comeback. You can walk us through the moments if you'd like.
I think the moments came later in the ball game with runners on base, finally getting scoring opportunities, but then creating chaos on the base path. This is one instance where the tag was not called applied, runs scored, and then base hits coming up clutch. And then this play at the plate, initially called out, and after a long review, reverse that ties the ball game. And that really just feels like it puts Rock back in the game. And then Jazz coming through with the bases, scored another couple of runs, putting her team on top. And then it was just a matter of going back out on defense and slamming the door, getting the three outs to win the championship.
They did just that. What a blast it was to be a part of this game and certainly bring it into your home wherever you watched it. PGF born in 2010, and look what it's grown into. You're all grown up, baby. But thousands of college athletes that have come through these doors, much like we'll go on with the Beverly Bandits and the Rock Gold. On behalf of our production team, everyone here with PGF, our good friends and partners with ESPN, My broadcast partner, Amanda Freedom, my boss in the truck, John Walsh. My name is Darren Sutton. The Rock Gold, do it again. See you soon at the ballpark.